The Financial Survival Network, helping you to survive and thrive in the new economy. To find out where to buy gold and silver reliably at great prices, go get your free financial survival toolkit at financialsurvivalnetwork.com. You'll also get our complimentary newsletter. This is the Financial Survival Network.
1490 WGCH. This is Kerry Lutz, and you're listening to the Financial Survival Network, which is brought to you by Miles Franklin. They've been in business selling gold and silver for over 20 years, and I'm a customer because when you buy, they ship. For more information, find them on the web at milesfranklin.com or give them a call at 800-822-8080 and get a free quote.
There's a major meeting of freedom lovers from all over the world coming to Las Vegas on July 11th. Freedom Fest is a must if you care about individual rights and your ability to peacefully and peaceably pursue your goals. And Mark Skousen is the founder of Freedom Fest and editor of Forecasts and Strategies. Mark, how are you?
Hey, I'm doing really well. How are you doing?
All right. I so appreciate your taking time out because I know the last few days before a major conference like yours is pure insanity. So we're grateful that you broke off from all the efforts that you're engaged in to talk to us for a couple of minutes. And obviously the big news, Obamacare being affirmed, purportedly affirmed by the Supreme Court.
Yes, and our phones have been ringing off the hook. It's been electrifying. We're actually having an emergency session our very first day of the conference, and we're having a series of top experts addressing this issue and what the fallout is. What does this mean for our country? What does it mean for the future of interpretation of the Constitution? What does it mean for healthcare? And we'll have a standing room only crowd on our first day, which will be July 12th, at Bally's in Las Vegas. And we have John Goodman, for example, who's written a book, Priceless, about the healthcare crisis. And he's kind of been in the forefront of providing information on free market alternatives to Obamacare. So he's going to give us an update on that. We have John Mackey of Whole Foods Markets, who is great. In fact, he was just telling me that he's actually energized and giving for the first time money to the Republican Party. He's so mad that he thinks this year it's so critical to reverse this, and basically Roberts, the Chief Justice, is a turncoat here and has basically thrown in the towel to the socialists and the statists. I don't ever call them liberal because they're not really liberal when it comes to liberty, which is the origin of that word. So I never give them that kind of credit. But I think this was a travesty, a worse form of travesty that Chief Justice Roberts engaged in. And it basically just opens up the door for unlimited government. There's no such thing as limited government anymore if the government can prohibit anything and mandate anything. And we're moving in that direction. So we're really excited about our speakers. Judge Napolitano will be there. He will dissect what is going on here. But there's no question that, Senator Rand Paul is going to be there. He's going to give us a report from Capitol Hill. But everybody is energized in the freedom movement. So that's the silver lining in it. But it would have been much better if the Supreme Court had simply said, like the four dissenting opinions, that the whole thing is unconstitutional and should be thrown out. And Chief Justice Roberts, for whatever reason he did it, I think is a travesty of justice. And I'm not sure, it's still a very big question mark whether we're going to be able to reverse this Obamacare decision. Even if the Republicans take over and everything, they'll be filibustering. It's not going to be easy, and there'll probably be compromises.
Yeah, no doubt. And one thing, I was kind of I was surprised by the decision, but not shocked, because being a lawyer, I have to admit, a reformed lawyer, I always said if I was any good at being a lawyer, I wouldn't still be practicing, and finally I'm not. But the fact is that it doesn't shock me, because when you go to court, it's a crapshoot. You can never count on the judicial system to do justice. Anyone who believes that it's going to do justice and do the right thing is extremely naive and doesn't really understand the purpose of the system and how it in fact works. But one thing, and it's been pointed out by commentators, not at all my own observation, but two things actually. Number one, it found the Commerce Clause, which Congress used as justification to pass it, as being unconstitutional. And number two is that it allows the states that don't want to be part of it to opt in, because the federal government can no longer withhold Medicaid funds to force them to implement Obamacare. So we got 26 states that aren't going to have any part of this in all likelihood. But the final thing is, and I think he was too clever by half, if this was really his intention to do all this, just make the thing unconstitutional, but to energize the Republicans to sweep Obama out of office certainly is an effect of it. But in the final analysis, I'm with you. I believe it will backfire, because I don't believe the Republicans will have either the will or the stomach to repeal it. And they certainly could if they get enough numbers in Congress. But I don't believe they're going to do it, because I don't believe they stand for limited government and freedom by any stretch. Do you?
Yeah, but you do have this strong Tea Party element, though, that is really holding these people to the fire. I mean, look what Senator Hatch had to go through in Utah. He had to basically backtrack completely in order to get reelected. So the Tea Party movement's very strong here in this regard, and I think they're going to hold their feet to the fire, and the Republicans are going to make every attempt to absolutely repeal it. I mean, they've made such a big deal, even Romney has in the election, that I mean, we would become totally callous as a people if he wasn't able to do that. And besides, it's such a heavy burden that it's to the advantage they're going to keep some elements of it. They'll get rid of it, but they'll keep some of the elements and that everybody seems to feel more comfortable with. But I think it was a big mistake overall, because it would have been better. Here's my thinking: if it had been 5-4 decision on ideological lines, yes, it would have been ideological lines. But then the result would be: hey, Obama, look, you passed legislation, you pushed through legislation that was totally unconstitutional. You violated your condition, and this was one of your big landmark cases. And see, so I think the Republicans could make hay either way on this case. So I would much rather Roberts not play these little games and make him, you notice he's become the one-man show here. I find it very interesting. This is actually a form of game theory.
Yeah, exactly.
From
exactly.
Mike's perspective, because he saw, after the arguments, Roberts saw that it was 4-4, and he said, well, if I'm on the side of the free market justices, then Justice Kennedy is going to get all, he's the swing vote, not me. He's viewed as the swing vote. He was on the cover of Time magazine as the swing vote. However, if I go to the side of the status, then I'm the swing vote. Now, that may sound really callous as a reason, a rather egotistical reason.
It sounds a little cynical, perhaps, Mark.
Quite cynical, but you know what? I'll bet you that was in the back of his mind, because everybody now on the front page, it's all about him, isn't it?
Yeah, like how can he do this?
Who would have thunk?
Who would have thunk? But one thing I want to raise here is that Romney's fundraising in the 24 hours since Obamacare was affirmed by the court, $4.6 million. So if this guy was gaming us and playing the game theory and manipulating a confluence of events to somehow try to change the administration. And of course, Supreme Court justices never do that, like Felix Frankfurter. You know, they're not political at all. But if this was his game, boy, I think it's really could blow up in everybody's face.
Well, yeah, so victory means defeat. Victory in the short term means failure or a big loss in November. And that could be the case. And maybe we should reward Justice Roberts if this is, in fact, what happened. But I kind of suspect that this is the rule of unintended consequences that we're recognizing here. At any rate, I do think, getting back to Freedom Fest, our emergency session, there's no question that people feel energized about it, and we're getting a very big response, and I hope any of your people who are listening that they will join us. You know, the whole objective of Freedom Fest is Ben Franklin's statement that if we don't hang together, we'll hang separately. And too often, we don't combine efforts to fight. And I've worked now 5 years. This will be our sixth year at Freedom Fest to bring everybody together. And it's working. Finally, I'm getting all the think tanks, the free market think tanks and the freedom organizations are putting aside their differences and coming together because the enemy is outside. It's not within us. It's not between us. It's out there. And we really need to come together more than ever, in my opinion. And that's the whole idea behind Freedom Fest. And we're, you know, when people ask me what's Freedom Fest about, I mean, my answer is everything. I mean, we talk philosophy and history and politics. You've been there.
Yeah.
You know, it's everything. We even have a film festival, the Anthem mm-hmm. Film Festival. We have a little bit of everything there, and people run around with their heads chopped off practically because there's so much fun things to do.
Yeah. I mean, Mark, from what I understand, somewhere around 30 to 50 Financial Survival Network listeners, you're going to be coming there. Make sure you come up to me. I'm going to have a booth. I'm going to be doing lots of interviews. And, you know, we've been sounding the word. I know people from our group are coming. And I think, I don't know if you know him, Robert Ian. He's going to be around. He just happens to live in Vegas. Uh-huh. And, you know, I'm looking forward to working with you guys, moderating whatever you want me to do. But I'll be recording continuously and we'll be pumping out content. I'm going to try to do it live from the show. If I get a decent internet connection, then I'll just start pumping it out live and we'll stream. But it's going to be a great experience. And I think you're going to see that attendance will spike as a result of this. It's a perfect storm for people to start thinking about liberty and freedom and what all that means and how you're losing it. You are losing your freedom as we speak because your choices are being restricted and your choices are being controlled. My headline after interview I did with Yaron Brook of the Ayn Rand Institute yesterday was...
Who will be there, by the way.
Yeah, Yaron will be there. Yeah, first time, which I'm really looking forward to. My headline was Yaron Brook, the Supreme Court shrugged, and now we all eat broccoli.
Well, you know, I'll never forget. I was at a Mount Pelerin Society meeting in Argentina a couple years ago, and the former president of Bolivia, and I can't remember his name, he gets up and he says, in our country, more and more, everything is either prohibited or mandated. And when I wrote that down because I thought, wow, that's what's happening to us.
Yeah,
and,
totally.
And yeah, and so both sides of the freedom side, where we're being prohibited from doing things we want to do, or we're being mandated to do things we don't want to do. Those are two. They're two sides of the freedom coin.
Yeah, totally.
And so I think that's why I have felt a sense of urgency, and we all have that. You know, the same thing that we've been doing before where we all kind of do our own thing isn't good enough. I mean, the opposition is so well organized compared to the freedom movement that I think we need to come together. And I don't have an agenda per se. I don't know where this is going to be headed. I just want to put it together so that everybody's coming together and can learn from each other. Learning is so important. Instead of always constantly doing your thing, you want to go and learn what others are doing. And then you network and you socialize and you celebrate liberty. I mean, the funnest thing about Freedom Fest is walking into that exhibit hall. When you walk into that exhibit hall and you feel the buzz, you feel the energy, it's an incredible feeling, isn't it?
You know what it was? I went to this meeting one time, the Committee for Monetary Responsibility, something else.
Yeah,
I met all these Austrian guys, and it was like, I feel like I came home. Then I went to Freedom Fest, and libertarians and anarchists and everybody who opposes infringement of personal freedom was there.
Yeah.
And I said, now I've really come home. There's 2,500 other people who don't think the way I think, but believe the way I believe. I don't want people to think the way I think. You don't want people to think the way you think. You want them to believe in their own personal sovereignty, that they are supreme and the state serves you. That's the state's purpose under the Constitution, is to be subservient to the people. And that is what we've lost, and that is what we need to get back.
And, you know, one of the things we try to emphasize is individualism at Freedom Fest. In other words, we don't have to label you. You have your opinion. I have my opinion. We have a civil debate. We're not yelling at each other. And, you know, we've lost that. We've lost that that sense of responsibility and culture. And it's just really nice to, in fact, I've had quite a few what I call social democrats who come there, and people who believe in big government and that sort of thing. And, you know, they're investors, so they come to the investment part of the conference, and they listen to the others. I've had some wonderful emails from people saying, you know, you really taught me that there's a respectable alternative view, and I'm starting to think differently now about things. It's almost like they've been converted, if you will, to the libertarian way of thinking, and it was done without malice, without yelling at each other, which I don't think accomplishes anything. You know, the stuff that you see on Fox News, where they're demonizing everybody, and they're getting to these fights, and MSNBC is the same way. And it's just nice at Freedom Fest. You know, we have like 7 or 8 debates. We're debating Winston Churchill this time, which is really going to be a fun one. We're debating the vaccine debate, Wall Street on trial. There's our mock trial. And we have a debate on philosophy. Is man a machine, a moral animal, or divinely human? So it's kind of a science and religion debate there. We have all of these debates, and we make them formal debates. And the reason we make them formal is because we don't want a shouting match. We're there to learn and hear two perspectives and make up our own mind. That's what it's all about, individualism.
Absolutely. You make such a great point that the loss of debate, where going back to the founding fathers, Hamilton hated Jefferson. Jefferson hated Hamilton, certainly after a while, in any event, after the Republic was formed. Mm-hmm. But the debate continued regardless of their animosity, and it was quite bitter, but there was a legitimate debate. And as much as a Rush Limbaugh perhaps is good at expressing conservative ideals, not necessarily liberty ideas or free market ideas, nonetheless, it becomes a food fight rather than a structured, intelligent debate. And that's what we need to go back to in this country. That's what you need to be doing. And that's what you are helping to bring about, Mark. So we are going to see you July 11th through the 14th at Bally's in Vegas. And I can't wait.
I can't wait either, and our website is freedomfest.com. We still have room for anybody who would like to come. In fact, one of the things I like to tell people is that, you know, why not? If the airfare is a little expensive, a lot of people are driving, and I asked people what city in the United States, what major city in the United States still has free parking everywhere, and there's only one, Las Vegas. So you can park, drive there, and park your car all the whole time, and get a cheap hotel room, and come to Freedom Fest. It's fun.
Absolutely, and don't forget financialsurvivalnetwork.com. We will be there. We'll have a link to Freedom Fest. And Mark, keep up the great work, and we'll see you soon.
All right, Kerry, take care.
Be well.